I do all that? That's cool. So, I want to thank you all for welcoming me back to North Carolina. Everybody thinks I live in North Carolina because I'm here so much. Like every 2 weeks, I find myself back in North Carolina from the D.C. area doing one program or another. I just finished with the CFSA conference in Durham, and I was surrounded by, over 1,000 organic farmers, producers from across the Carolinas. And I'm going to the Gullah Geechee Festival in St. Helena Island by Greyhound, so pray for me. From the Raleigh Greyhound Station, the Ellis Island of the Black North Carolinian. So you can laugh at that. It's really not a big deal. So I'm here tonight to give you a little bit of flavor, a taste of where I'm coming from. I don't want to just say Jews of color, but Jews of African descent in America, where they're not 10 of us. It's not like one minion and we just travel everywhere. There are actually over 50,000 of us, and we come from very different places. We are converts. We are not converts. We're people who have been Jewish for generations. We're people who have always been Black and Jewish since day one. We are people who are biracial. We are adopted. We have every single narrative that every other Jew in America has. And it's very important to say to you guys that, just like I said this afternoon, that when you meet a Jew of color, don't immediately delve into, are you valid? Are you authentic? Were you born Jewish or were you raised Jewish? Did you convert? Since nobody asked you those questions, don't ask them those questions. Ask them their name first. Shake their hand, give them a hug for even surviving life in a society that doesn't really tolerate intersectionality. So the first thing is, what is your name? Where are you from? And as a Hebrew school teacher, and by the way, I've noticed several of my Hebrew school students are here at Elam. I'm very proud of that. It's like, hey, Mr. Twitty. And I'm like, wow, I'm old. 15 years of the Hebrew school business. And I'm privileged to say that I've taught at 6 synagogues in the D.C. area and over 1,000 students during that time period. From Orthodox, Conservative, Reform, Reconstructionist, Independent Havarah, and Humanist synagogues. So every single part of the Jewish spectrum. So I wear many different kippahs and fedoras and strimals. So, maybe not strimals, there's not too many Black gay Jews in Chabad, but there might be one day, just you wait, I'll get them too. So, I am modern Orthodox by shul, I am flexodox by practice, I am conformative by outlook, and I am completely New York Times crossword puzzle Jew when it comes to food. Food is a great way for people to sort of understand where I'm coming from because, as I started with people of African descent who are Jewish, we face a lot of different questions about our identity. And it's really quite funny seeing that, on the continent of Africa, Jews have been there since the get-go. And we've always been brown and Black. And there, when some of you guys come over there and visit, they go, look at you and go, are you sure you're Jewish? You don't look Jewish. So when I cook this food, I say kosher soul. It's not really so much of a joke about fusion. There's no fusion. They're just intertwined braids, just like a challah, intertwined braids of an identity. It's kind of like when you have African-American folk who are Muslim and they eat halal. There's a certain way they do food. I mean, we've had halal soul food for generations upon generations. In fact, the first halal soul food goes back to slavery times when there were actually practicing Muslims in slavery who would not eat pork, so they would eat other things. So we have a long-standing tradition. There have been African Americans who have been cooking kosher food since slavery times in this country. The Moses Myers House in Norfolk, Virginia, you will learn that the enslaved cook there had to know the laws of kashrut, and that family, unlike many other Jews in the South at the time, actually did keep kosher because the slaveholder Moses Myers only bought shellfish for his enslaved workers as food for them. So there are many examples from New York, from Savannah, from Charleston, of African-American folks making Jewish food. And one of the people that I brought up this afternoon was my was someone I was only privileged to meet once in person and talked quite often with, Mrs. Mildred Covert. She was like, I call her the real Draft Miss Daisy. She was from New Orleans. She just passed away this year, and she was in her 90s, and she was one of those people that's sharp to the end, really sharp. And she emailed me by way of a former Hebrew school student of hers. That's, you talk about a way back. And she said, young man, when you come to New Orleans, I saw you on the cover of Southern Jewish Life. That's right, I'm a centerfold. You love it. She said, I saw you on the cover of Southern Jewish Life, and I want you to meet with me when you're in New Orleans. You will be meeting with me. I'm like, okay, dang, all right, no choice. Get in the car. So she took me around New Orleans with her former Hebrew school student who's a journalist in New Orleans, and showed me the synagogue that's now a church she used to attend. She grew up Orthodox. She said to me, you know, I read a little bit about your story, but I want you to know something. I want you to know the history of Creole food and the Jews did, and soul food that Jews did in New Orleans. She wrote three cookbooks: the Kosher Creole Cookbook, the Kosher Cajun Cookbook, and the Kosher Confederate Cookbook, which got changed to the Kosher Southern Cookbook. Just so you're, but the cover is still kind of spicy. It's a Hasidic Rebbe and like a dude in like a Robert E. Lee kind of get up. I'm like, okay. It's the only cookbook in my collection that has a book jacket. So I won't, so people don't like have it out with me. But she said something really amazing. She said, who do you think we learn to cook from down on Dryad Street? Our black neighbors. She said, if anybody, any Jew in the South tells you they did not learn how to cook American Southern food from a black woman, they're lying to you. And she went through this whole story, you know. I don't know many of you who know anyone who still had the accent or came over on the boat. That's a dying generation for a lot of people. That ancestor, that grandmother, that grandfather who left everything behind to immigrate to America. And when they left, they didn't go back. So her mother immigrated from Galicia. She immigrated from a country that doesn't even exist anymore. That's Austrian Poland, by the way. It's part of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. You know, that's the kind of history she was bringing to me. Her mother immigrated from the Austro-Hungarian Empire. Think about that one more time. She was the first and only child born in America. The rest of her brothers and sisters were born in Europe. And when her mother got off the boat at the docks in New Orleans, she bought a hand of bananas, a fruit she'd never seen before. And she tried to eat them whole because no one in her life had ever seen or eaten a banana. And her mother didn't even trust tomatoes because she thought they contained blood. And of course, in Kashrut, we don't eat blood. So her mother was really sort of out of, you know, kilter with this whole new American experience. But she said, you know, those of us who came from Eastern Europe at that time learned how to cook and eat and become Americans through food through our black neighbors. And she said, the women who worked for us and with us were our teachers. And so I asked her, I said, well, how did you learn to cook so well? It was Creole food, Cajun food. It's, you know, really heavy on treif and really heavy on pork and shellfish. And she said, well, you know, young man, I grew up Orthodox, but my husband did not grow up Orthodox. So I learned a few things in the first few years of marriage, but I turned him around. Well, she said, I make the best kosher stuffed crab you ever had. She winked at me. So that told me a little bit about her journey as well. So for me, kosher soul food is more than just making like the soul food kosher by Jewish law. It's about blending the two diasporas. Wherever Jews have been in the world, Africans have been in the world. And they sort of Venn diagram in these amazing combinations. So people kind of look at me and go, that's kind of weird. I don't know if I understand that, your identity. But as I said this afternoon, authenticity is a box people put you in when they can't wrap their head around the fact that you were just as authentic as they are. So that's a trap people use. You know, at the Walters Art Gallery in Baltimore, I live in Maryland, there was a beautiful painting during an exhibit on Africans in Renaissance Europe. It was huge. It literally said, "The Blacks and Jews of Lisbon," and it was painted around 1500.
That's wonderful.
I can yell. Watching the train wreck.
Coming.
Love it. I have big ears. You know this, right?
No, I got it.
There we go. Awesome.
Is that better? Comfortable?
Perfect.
Great.
It kind of reminds me of, you remember Janet Jackson and Rhythm Nation video? That's how I feel right now. Or Britney, you know, Britney rocked that little headset. You know, Britney, Janet, and me, you know. Back off, Taylor. Some of y'all got that. I know who you are. But there's this big, huge painting called The Blacks and the Jews of Lisbon. It's painted in 1500. And it's showing that the black community and the Jewish community live side by side in Portugal. And I'm thinking to myself, they had to have combined food and recipes. There's just no way. There was a lot of things going on in this picture. There was praying, there was prostitution. Food comes next. I'm just saying. That is kind of true, isn't it? Yes. So, black IP hummus, why? Why? So I could have made for you kosher soul rolls and make kosher soul rolls for Andrew Zimmern on Bizarre Foods America, and he eat every single one of them, like a vacuum cleaner. Like, homeboy eats, I thought, you know, these little cooking shows, I've been to many of them and work with people, and you literally see most folks take that one bite, smile like the little Rachel Ray smile, and then they spit it out right after. Not Andrew Zimmern. Mm-mm. Like a walrus, like a manatee, he just went. Everything is up. I love you, Andrew, whenever you see this. Please invite me back to your show. But I made enough kosher soul rolls for his crew, and they were just like, oh, man, we're used to it. We knew we're not going to eat those. So, by the way, kosher soul rolls, why? What do blacks and Jews love the most? Chinese food. So I decided to make a spring roll that's black and Jewish. Okay, and it has a brisk, just kidding. So, he said that, yes he did. So, it has pastrami collard greens in it. You know, it has its own like the South Carolina mustard barbecue sauce dip. Oh, it's delicious. But y'all ain't getting the recipe till the cookbook's written. So don't even start. Don't be emailing me talking about, Mr. Twitty, can I have the rent? No. This is not a 1950s housewife Tupperware party, boo. I don't give out my recipes like that. So slow your roll, stay in the lane. You know, I make collard green kreplach, which are great. And I like to play with that. These, you know, standard soul food ingredients made in ways that, you know, play with traditional Eastern European or Sephardic Jewish food. With Sephardic Jewish food, it's a little bit harder to be kitschy and fun because Sephardic food basically has the same ingredients as most West African and North African food. The okra is there, the black-eyed peas, the hot peppers, the cornmeal is there. So it's not, you're just kind of like sliding together your mutually agreeable pieces, but people really see the contrast when you do more Eastern European food. So I do another dish called Yiddish Aribinus. Because, you know, Ashkenazi Jewish food does not really have a lot of spices in it or flavor that really comes out at you. So you have to kind of work with what you have, which is paprika, horseradish, black pepper, garlic. I got all of them in there. Anything in the Ashkenazi universe that had some kind of seasoning or flavor, I put it in the beef barbecue rib thing with no barbecue sauce, just those flavors coming out, and it's actually quite good. And I tell you, when you put the horseradish with the beet juice in it, the crane, it comes out really pretty. But black IP hummus actually works really nicely because it tells two narratives. So one narrative is that black-eyed peas are an African cultigen. They come from West Africa about 8,000 or more years ago, and they spread to the rest of the world. So everybody who eats cow peas in the world owes their existence to where Niger and Chad meet in the Sahel region, which used to be a fertile, lush grassland once upon a time. Black-eyed peas grow in very drought-like conditions, and they're a staple food from Senegal to Angola, where my West Central African ancestors came from. And they're pretty much eaten all over Africa right now, to this day. They spread, of course, through the Middle East, and then into the Mediterranean, and then during the slave trade, they came to the Americas. So if I was in Brazil, I would take this mush right now, roll up into a ball, and make acarajé, which is an exact copy of acará, which is a food from Nigeria, which is black-eyed pea fritters. And if you go into Antebellum America in South Carolina, Virginia, they both made black-eyed pea cakes. Where do they get those from? I wonder. Then don't say Paula Deen or else I'll cut you. No, baby. She can dance with the star, but she can't dance with me. Black-eyed peas became a staple of Southern food and soul food because they were one of the foods that could travel on the Middle Passage and survive the journey. So as a dried seed, you plant them, they're very productive, and they're also very nutritious for you, and they're very filling. On the other end, when black-eyed peas or lubia or rubia go to the Middle East, they become a staple of Sephardic and Mizrahi Jewish food. Sephardic means Jews from the Mediterranean and Middle East. Mizrahi means Jews from the Middle East and Central Asia, going into Iran and Central Asia. On Rosh Hashanah, which is what? One of the four New Years in Jewish tradition, some Sephardic Jews, some Mizrahi Jews, have a Seder, or a ritual meal, that is designed to incur blessings based on the puns of the names of the foods that you eat, you consume. So if you consume that food, it's less of a thing about luck. In other cultures, a luck issue, it's more of an issue of incurring mitzvot, or more commandments, more good deeds, more connections to the Holy One, and to each other, and within oneself. And so you eat beet greens, and you eat carrots, and they all pretty much have the same meaning, which is kind of terrible. Tear up decrees, you know, mess up our enemies if they come for us. You know that beautiful saying, don't come for me unless I send for you. Exactly. We've been saying that for 2,000 years as the Jewish people. And everything else. And then black-eyed peas are meant to increase your mitzvot in the year to come. Your good deeds, which means good karma. There'll be good karma. If I do good, good will come back to me and vice versa. That's a New Year's dish. If you're in the South, what do you eat on New Year's? Black-eyed peas and collard greens. Why collard greens? Bonus points, wealth, cash. And black-eyed peas for change. Get it? Change, money, and luck, change of, So that's in there too. Now, if you go to West Africa, the black-eyed pea symbolizes the eye of God. It symbolizes fertility. And in Senegal, when you want a blessing on your business or your house or whatever, you don't just go to the imam or the traditional holy person and go, you know, can I have the blessing? You have to make a pot of niebe, or black-eyed peas, and you have to go find a mendicant, someone who's poor in the street, and you have to actually serve them the food. Look them in the eye. Don't treat them just like throw the good thing at them and then go ask for the blessing. You have to treat them like a human being. And when they're done eating their fill of the black-eyed peas, you have to say to them, just like the black-eyed pea flourishes where there is drought and nothingness, may you flourish despite your circumstances. And only then can you go back to the imam or the traditional holy man or holy woman and say, please bless me for my business. And that's an incredible lesson in values and ethics. And both of these traditions use food as a mnemonic device. Talk about history. Talk about ethics and values in ways that no other food traditions on earth do. So that's why I'm making black-eyed pea hummus. If you're in among the Yoruba people, the same people who gave you akara, the husband and wife eat black-eyed pea cakes for fertility on their wedding day, also for blessings of the Orisha or goddess Oshun, the goddess of love. So I don't want to make any claims on the Viagra-ness of this dish, but it's good for you. As my grandmother would say, and that was with a wink. You know, I knew what that meant. So here we go. So canned black-eyed peas, please. Do not sit up there and ball your own black-eyed peas and just say, here you go. See, I'm in North Carolina where you can say the word ball and people understand what you mean, as opposed to boil, because nobody's ever made boiled peanuts in their life. They're balled. Thank you very much. So Canned black-eyed peas. It doesn't look like much. It looks like cat food. That's okay. We're going to rock with that. Now, one of the things that I did before you came was I took lemons and I juiced them because it's one of the hardest tasks. And this dish requires somewhere between 10 and 20 lemons. And you're going, wait a minute, that sounds like a lot of lemon. Yes, because black-eyed peas are very earthy. And like chickpeas, they actually suck up every bit of flavor you put into them. So you have to kind of keep the lemon juice high, the acid high, so you actually taste it, and it levels out the earthiness. So I know some folks here don't like black because they're very earthy tasting, but this is really good. So now that I did the lemon juice part, you could do this all on here, but remember, in my other life, I play an enslaved cook. I don't really use food processors and computers and smartphones and other things that make your life a hell of a lot easier. So I'm used to using my hands and getting very physical with the food, which is something I think we've lost in modern kitchens. So you can pretty much see what's going on. We have tahini and we have olive oil, which I will think I'll put in first. And don't ask me for measurements, because you're not going to get any. Not because I don't like you. It's because you have to eyeball it. So let's just eyeball it and see how it works. Trust me, it'll always come out good. It's never the same amount any given time, so, eh. So I'm going to say if I had to, it was about 6 to 8 cans of black-eyed peas. Let's just say there were 6. So that requires about a cup of tahini. Let's go with that. Does that work for you? It works for me. Okay, great. So there's our cup or so. If I was, you know, liquored up, this would be great. You know, but I don't really drink, so shame on me. And so that's all going to blend in. It looks like a lot, but trust me. Like I said, the black-eyed peas suck everything up. So it's not going to last very long. Within about a minute, you won't be able to see the tahini at all. So tahini is sesame. And sesame is another food that has Afro-Asiatic origins. It was popularized in the South by enslaved Africans. And sesame was certainly very important to the Jewish diaspora. Now, garlic. Olive oil and garlic should go next. You know, there was a cookbook that inspired some of my work in historic African-American foodways. It was a cookbook that was written about a half a cup. A cookbook that was written about the Jews of Spain during the medieval times and how the Inquisition went down. And it said that Jews were persecuted because they cooked with garlic. Now you think about Spanish food and you think, of course Spanish food has garlic in it now. But they said that there were actually people who went around from pot to pot to pot, checking the cooking pots of former Jews who had converted to Christianity for two things, pork. And some of their families would have two pots. They have the pot that they would check and the pot that they would actually eat, and they would check for the presence of a lot of garlic. So it's like when you study food history, you think about things like that. Every time you use an ingredient, you think about the stories behind the food, and it makes the food into a different experience. We're really bad about that. You know, we love to talk about where the chicken came from and where this came from, where the vegetable came from. But we're really bad at two things, the ethics of how our food gets to us and the history behind it that tells us how we're connected to everybody else on planet Earth. So we're gonna do the garlic next. This looks like a lot of garlic. It is, and I like it that way. I don't like vampires. So God forbid there should be a kind of horror on this house. And green onion. That's in everything. I don't know about you, but in my household, there were always several things. Lemon, green onion, everything, and hot pepper. So we're going to stir that up. You can have strong arms to do this, by the way. Takes a lot of heft. And then in quick succession, paprika. Okay? Yeah. Need some color in it. Hot pepper. You can do hot sauce or cayenne. It's a pinch. I have big fingers, so my pinches are bigger than yours. about a tablespoon of salt, black pepper, about a teaspoon of that, cumin, a lot of cumin, probably about, I don't know, probably about 2 teaspoons, and some brown sugar. Now, if this sounds familiar to you, it should, because what makes this kosher soulish? It's basically barbecue rub. I know. So, now we stir and pray. And it should look a nice, it should go from being slightly pink to a little more orangey looking with the paprika. And it's really a dump cooking dish. You just kind of like taste it and let it work, taste it, let it work, taste it, let it work. Okay, esteemed professors, we have to eat. So would you two grab some spoons and try this for me? Okay, fantastic. Like, yeah. Okay, we need to get you some spoons. Then we can try. Yeah, she about to put her hand up in this. She wouldn't. Is that right? If you're wondering why I did that, not having tasted it, because I know. Hey, you do. You cook on enough plantations on open hearth, and you'd start to learn some stuff about cooking. All right. Mishpacha, try a little bit. Tell me if it needs anything. It's good?
Good.
Great? Yeah. Okay. No salt, no pepper? Nope. All right, cool. Fantastic. So I'm going to hand this over to our lovely dining staff. And you're going to be able to have this fresh black-eyed pea hummus with your meal. See, nice and orangey. That works for me. Enough garlic? Okay. I was going to do that anyway, but, you know, you gave her brother permission, so I'm going to roll with it. I'm going to rock it. I promise you, this is going to be very heady on the garlic, but it's all right. Like I said, no vampires. Okay, awesome. So they should, but we also want to get this to our folks so we can put it up. They can put it up there, and I can spread it out, and we can include that in the repertoire. So I think what we're going to do is, when Professor Clausen comes back and gives us the say-so, you guys are going to get a plate of some of my recipes. We're going to enjoy them. I'm going to take a little bit of a break to eat as well. And then we'll come back to the program. Sound good to you? Okay, bete avon. All right, so sambala is this locust bean paste. And you can get it from African markets, West African markets. And it kind of functions like soy sauce. Like a dark umami flavor, but I seriously doubt there's sambala in North Carolina. So soy sauce works pretty good in a pinch. So who likes the African fried rice? Yes, good. Y'all gonna clap. Oh, y'all like, like it was kindergarten, workout. And who likes the collard greens? Awesome. Fantastic. So I have a recipe for collard sprouts, and this is a really cool idea. Collard greens produce a sprout just like other brassicas do, like cauliflower and broccoli. And they're really tender, and they're really good, and the fluorescence of the collard green in the spring is really tasty. But we don't have those this time of year, and quite frankly, if you don't grow them, you don't have them. So they just use collard greens. I think they turned out really good. For a meatless meal, which is kind of awesome. So one of the things that I like to do is give people who come to my blog, Afroculinaria, the option of having foods that I can shout better than they can. having foods that are part of the tradition, but give them a little bit of a healthier option. My goal is not to preach to people about healthy eating. My goal is to simply give them the food ways, the traditions as they are expressed. You know, we don't actually come from a grease-laden fry culture. Actually, most of our food in the Caribbean, in West Africa, and in the South is actually pretty decent for you to eat. It's pretty healthy for you as is. And so my goal is to bring people of color back to that notion that our food doesn't have to be healthed up or low-cal. It's pretty decent as it is, and we should explore recipes that kind of bring out the natural flavors of our food. So that's the deal with the food. At this point, we have about 25 minutes or so, and I would actually like to have a little bit of a dialogue with you and not talk at you. So I would appreciate if anyone has a comment or a question or anything of that nature, I'd be glad to entertain them. Yes, sir?
How did you start your own personal journey and identification with Judaism?
Great question. So, always in the first day of Hebrew school is the first question the kids ask me. Although, not so much anymore. I think everybody knows who I am. I'm pretty much the raisin in the kugel in every synagogue I go to. But when I was 7 years old, I saw the movie The Chosen on television. And the movie The Chosen is this 80s movie based on a Chaim Potok novel from many years before. And it was about two friends growing up in Brooklyn. One is modern Orthodox and the other one is Hasidic. And it talks about their friendship, and the Hasidic boy, his father is kind of like a fictional Rebbe, a Hasidic spiritual master. And there's a scene in that movie that really like got to me. And I was 7 years old, where the character's father was played by Rod Steiger, who was the same actor who was in The Heat of the Night with Sidney Poitier. He goes into a state of dvekus. And dvekus is a Yiddish Hasidic term for dvekut, which is Kabbalah, devek in Hebrew, which means to glue. He was glued to the Spirit of the Lord. And so I understood this sort of like ecstatic spiritual ecstasy thing going on, and I don't know why, but something clicked in my head and I said, that's me. I had no idea why I said this. And as I went on my journey in other ways in talking about ethnicity and roots and heritage, I've had more than one weird that's me moment. And you can't explain them any other way than I think there's blood memory, I think there's something spiritual about it. It's not just Judaism, it's been with a lot of my African ethnic connections. It's, you know, going into a museum and just hovering around a certain mask for hours, and then you find out later that through a DNA test that's your people. Or you think about my Scandinavian roots, and I knew that when I was in the third grade, no one believed me. Then I find out that's my largest European DNA. It's from Norway and Sweden. Surprise, I'm a brother. But Judaism, as I grew up in a community in Montgomery County that had, 60% of DC area's Jews live in Montgomery County. It wasn't a big surprise or secret. My mother grew up in Cincinnati, large Jewish population, large African-American population. And I think it's really important to note that, just like Mrs. Colbert said, a blessed memory, there's a lot of places where African-Americans and Jews have lived in very close quarters, although side by side. And so, no, it's no surprise there were a lot of Jewish jazz musicians. And no, it's not a surprise that there are a lot of African-Americans who cooked Jewish food or cooked kosher food. And no, it's not a surprise that the Civil Rights Movement had a lot of Jews and African-Americans working together. It's not at all. You know, and not even then, but before the Scottsboro Boys case, those were Jewish lawyers who came to the aid of these African-American young men. And so there are all these connections in music and culture and law and literature and political movements and social justice that bring people together. So in my community, I remember when I was 8, 9 years old, helping to build the sukkah. To me, that was just like going to somebody's house for a Christmas tree. I didn't know the difference. And I didn't grow up. I grew up in a community, multicultural suburb where we were all 2 to 3 paychecks away from destitution, but we didn't know it because our parents never let on that we were that poor. We didn't feel poor. We felt middle class. But we weren't really middle class. We weren't really working class either. Half our parents had degrees, and we didn't know the difference. But the one thing about us is that we grew up with people from every background in a community. And I didn't know for a long time that even to this day, that's not how a lot of Americans live. I just thought everybody, you know, had Indian, Lebanese, Korean, Greek, Turkish, African-American, Jamaican, Nigerian friends. And they just hung out together. And those grandmothers fed you, you know. You go over somebody's house. That's how I learned about food from all over the world, because you go over somebody's house, they didn't speak English. They just fed you, and you ate it, because if you didn't eat it, that was disrespectful. And they would tell you so. They knew that those two words in English. And you would eat it, and you become part of somebody else's culture. And you would learn things. And so that's how my palate got expanded. You go to synagogue. You went to synagogue because you got invited to a bar mitzvah every other week. Okay? And so later on, when I started doing more things as an adult, I became part of the Smithsonian Folklife Festival in D.C. as an intern multiple times, and I did Jewish culture for the Washington, D.C. exhibit on the National Mall. And I worked with Joe Nathan, who's a good friend of mine now, who is like the master, the maven of Jewish American cooking. Learned how to make challah from her at her house. And then I went to Sephardic Synagogue, because I didn't want to just do an Ashkenazi Jewish D.C. community. And when I walked into that synagogue, the first person to come out and greet me was my friend Greg, who is also African-American, was the same age as me. Still, same age as me. And we were both, you know, young men in our early 20s. And by the second or third week, the rabbi was so kind to me that I said, okay, I'm going to keep going to this shul. And they let me wear a tallit. They let me practice wearing tefillin. This is kind of unheard of in other places. But they really were very welcoming. And so I converted at that synagogue with 3 Orthodox rabbis. And I think a lot of people who are born and raised in American Jewish communities who come from Jewish, they really want to know one particular thing, which is, why are you drawn? What are you seeing in this tradition that I'm not seeing and I'm born and raised in it? You know, that's a very interesting phenomenon in America that we don't really like to give life to. The fact that not just blacks and Jews, but multiple groups, people grow up in something and all they can't wait to leave it. But somebody else comes along and says, I really love this, their brain goes, wait a minute. There's a lot of people from outside of me liking and loving this. What am I not seeing that they're seeing about my identity, about my reality? And so, I don't know. I think I've thought about this question. I've tried to answer it. But here's my best shot at it. I think that for me in particular, Jewish spirituality, which is a very broad thing, as I said this afternoon, Judaism is a religion, but the Jewish people is a totally separate reality. You know, one rabbi put it in a much more direct and confrontational way. He said, Judaism is not a religion, it's the religious culture of the Jewish people. And I think he's right. I think he's right. So I have a hard time convincing a lot of my African-American cousins, friends, and kinfolk that no, Judaism is not just a religion. I hear that a lot in these confrontations. It's just a religion. No, you don't understand. It's like blackness is not just a phenotype. Blackness is bigger and more beyond that. It's a connective tissue that goes beyond what people look like and goes into how they think, how they feel, their common historical experiences. So for me, I think the biggest thing was the idea that argumentation is holy, that debate is holy, that questioning is holy, that searching and seeking and going over something over and over and over again until every single bit of its secrets is holy. And that's a very, you know, Sephardic, Kabbalistic, Hasidic way of looking at things. But ultimately for me that was a huge draw, that learning is a holy thing. It's not just a means to an end. You have to keep thinking and thinking and rethinking something until you've eaten every bit of holiness out of it. So it's my sincere conviction that, you know, human beings are these bizarre and interesting holy books. And every human being's soul is essentially a book in God's yeshiva. And our souls are what God, he, she studies in order to make and remake the universe. And that's a concept in Judaism that's very important. Also, you know, my work in food justice and culinary justice, I think it's very important to say that even though my focus is African-American folk in the South and sort of repatriating these skills and knowledge systems to our community and saying, no, we come from an incredible heritage of cooking and growing food and relating to nature, the idea of culinary justice and food justice for me partly owes itself to the idea that when I was learning and working with folks of Eastern European extraction, they came from these Bundist and social justice and social oriented communities that was passed down from, you know, Eastern Europe when emancipation came. This idea that, you know, another way of expressing Jewish identity is through sort of like this ethical pursuit of justice for all. And so I can't separate the culinary justice and food justice angle in my life, at least, from the experience of working with rabbis who had tzedakah gardens, rabbis who had marched to Selma, rabbis who were taught by Abraham Joshua Heschel, rabbis who learned with Reb Zalman and with Shlomo Carlebach, you know, people who had been active in the birth of the Reconstructionist movement and the birth of Jewish renewal. So all of that meant something to me. Even though I came through an Orthodox milieu, I picked up all these different parts. And that was also very exciting to me because as I taught in different synagogues, I picked up different parts of the Jewish story. The Orthodox perspective, I think I picked up a big emphasis on tradition. Conservative flexibility. Reform, a lot of the social justice came through that. Renewal, different ways of expressing, honoring different ways of expressing one's Judaism. And Reconstructionist, seeing the holiness of the civilization, not just the religion part. So I was able to pick up different components. Now to my African-American side, I also went back into my Black identity and I started seeing things that I hadn't seen before. So my whole approach to soul food, my whole approach to African-American food was African-American food is a text, just like Jewish food is a text. And it deserves our scrutiny because people look at it as this comforting, sort of like mindless, instinctual, happy-go-lucky thing. And it's how our people survive their oppression. And how you survive your oppression is your greatest form of cultural capital when you are oppressed. So I began to look at my African-American history as through food in the same way that people were looking at Jewish food history and Jewish food culture. And so there's this constant sort of shifting of pronouns in my brain, and this constant sort of like, you know, I bring my Black side into my Jewish side, my Jewish side to my Black side all the time. You know, my kids hear me, you know, I'm not in the classroom as much as I used to be, but my kids used to say to me, Mr. Twitty, you can be the first Jewish preacher. But I knew what they meant, you know? I knew what they were hearing in my voice and hearing in how I talked about Torah and text. Because I came from one of the most fantastic, you know, traditions of interpreting the meaning of text, the Black church, where, you know, not only is the scripture a song, but the sermon about the song is a song. So those two things meld together. And at the same time, I think what has set me apart in terms of how I look at African-American food and write about African-American food is I write about it the same way that rabbinical academics write about Talmud. There's something really serious and multi-level going on here, and you have to recognize that. That was a long answer to your question. But I just had to get a lot of energy out there. I felt a little bit of a flow going on. I hope that's okay. All right, cool. Yes, sir.
Was there a particular food or cooking / food experience that kind of kickstarted for you or revealed to you the whole historical, ethical implications of food that you were talking about earlier?
Oh, yeah. And I think that's a fantastic question. You know, myself and Professor Avital were just talking about, at the stroke of midnight, in both our households, black eyed peas. In her household, you were woken up, you had to eat the black eyed peas as part of the meal, the first meal on New Year's, right? In my household, I had to take the black eyed peas, the dried ones, and put them in everybody's wallet or purse at the stroke of midnight. And it's really something when you look at each other and go, you did something like that too? Your grandmother used to take the spoon and taste in the back of her wrist? Because you know, in our household, you didn't take the spoon and put it back in the pot. Oh no, honey. That guaranteed a whooping right quick. We didn't do that. But my grandma would put the little bit on the back, lick it off, and go wash her hand. And there were all these little customs and things. And so I said, this has to come from somewhere. But you know, when you're, I think there's a difference in language. I think when you are Jewish in America, you have the idea that somehow your tradition is ennobling. And when you're black in America, the idea that tradition is not. And I set out to change that. I was like, there are a lot of us who do feel our tradition is ennobling, but don't have access to the right language to make it so. So for me, it was the idea of reading those foods and those texts and seeing, what does this food mean in Brazilian culture, in Ethiopian culture, in Kenyan culture, in Alabama, in Virginia, North Carolina? What does it mean? What's the commonality of the collard greens in all these cultures? What does that tell me? What kind of trail can you take with that? So I really wanted to know all of those different pieces and put them together and sew them back together. For me, every time, you know, you sit down to a plate of okra and field peas and rice and collard greens and hot pepper, you're at a family reunion. All the different parts of our family coming back together again. And so I wanted to make it so that every time you sit and eat my food, you understand that my food is my flag. I don't need anything else. So that stands up for me and says, this is the world that you're coming into. And yes, it can be a universal. You know, just like Western civilization is supposedly universal for everybody, so is African civilization. It's a way of expressing our common humanity. Without Africa, there's no human beings. So, you know, we can play that game all night. But the bottom line for me is that the food is a text. And that text has mystical meanings, spiritual meanings, practical meanings, you know, meanings that can be historically documented, meanings that have to be felt in your heart, in your kishkas, in your brain, to comprehend. So, you know, I will tell you the four foods I don't like, and this questions my blackness and my Jewishness. I can't stand chitlins.
Yes.
I wouldn't eat them if I could eat them. Gefilte fish. Gefilte fish is an excuse to eat horseradish. If you ate horseradish by itself, they'd call you meshuggah. So you eat gefilte fish to sort of not be crazy. Dr. Brown celery soda. Get out of, I knew that was gonna happen. Nothing. It tastes like a doctor's sample. not that I have any knowledge. And pecha. Who knows pecha? Yes. What is pecha? Tell them what pecha is.
It's like hooves that have
been
made into a gelatin.
Hooves of a cow made into a gelatin with as much garlic and onion as you can possibly stomach. Because if you ate garlic and onion by themselves, you'd be meshuggah. But with the cow's foot, it's passable. So those are things I don't touch. Oh, and I don't eat watermelon in public. I ain't going out like that. Let me tell y'all a quick story, because you know I have to do a tangent, black, gay, and Jewish, tangents in all the time. I did an event in Mississippi at the called the Back of the Big House Tour, which is very important, because it was talking about the fact that slavery had been ignored for so long, and these antebellum pilgrimages, which they love to do in Mississippi. And so the queen of the pilgrimage came by the site where I was cooking, and I ran up in the house so fast, because there was no way in hell I would have my picture taken with the queen of the pilgrimage inspecting my cooking pots in her big crinoline hoop skirt and her fan. I'm like, oh no, not today, Satan. I ran up in there, she had her big, this like some little high school girl with her prince came up in a horse-drawn carriage, and I was like, oh, this ain't good. So I did a coup de kente and ran in the house. And I'm telling you right quick, she had this big hoop skirt, and they showed her, I was looking out the window like, and I Facebooked it too, I was like, Big Missy up in here looking at my cooking pots. And I'm looking out the window, and she almost burned her skirt because it was like drifting into the fire. And so I was like, there's certain things I just won't do. I will not take smiling pictures of people in my slave clothes wearing no antebellum hoop skirts. That'll be a cold day in hell before I do that. And I also won't eat watermelon in public. Don't ask me why, it's just my issues. They're not your issues. My grandfather personally thinks I'm crazy. He's 97, he says, you ain't no Twitty if you don't eat watermelon. And I said, oh well, that's the way it works. But all jokes about stereotypes aside, I don't think there are any foods that you know, get you out of the tribe, whatever your tribe is. And almost everybody has one that they won't touch, regardless of what ethnic group they're in. That's supposed to be the signature. If you're really part of us, you'll eat this. No, I won't. Mm-mm. Now, I'll eat gribbiness. You know what gribbiness are? They're the Jewish equivalent of pork rinds, although they're actually goose cracklings and chicken cracklings. But I won't. I've never touched a pork rind to save my life growing up. Like, oh, no. Mm-mm. No, ma'am. So that's in there. But brisket? Mm-mm. Yes. Good stuff. Matzo meal fried chicken? Mmm, yes. I actually had a guy write me an email several years ago and said, I love your West African brisket. And he said, I never get to cook Passover because my mother will not let me, because she's such a stickler, but I slipped in your West African brisket this year at Pesach, and she never complained once. Thank you. So that was kind of awesome. So people are making my food, and I really appreciate that and love that. It makes me feel like, you know, my work is being done. Every time someone has to have that dialogue of, why are we eating this? What's important about this? What is the history behind this? Where'd you get the recipe from? And they're having conversations that otherwise they wouldn't have. Anyone else? I'm getting progressively short of my answers as we go along. So that's a good thing.
One last question?
Anyone? One last question? Seriously? And black folks, you better ask a question. Because, I see y'all out there. I'm going to make a certain person ask a question if we don't have a volunteer. I'm putting y'all on the spot. Just like church on Sunday when the collection plate goes around. Questions? Do you have a question you'd like to ask me? Just because I would like to diversify this discussion.
So many questions coming to you.
Pick one.
let's see. I'm going blank. We just have so much in common, and our stories have just overlapped in so many ways. And I'm just wondering if you're thinking about ways that dialogues further, because I feel like I'm home with you, and I don't have that experience very often being a black woman in often all white Jewish communities, and someone who's able to embrace the culture that I very much still am a part in, the culture that I've embraced. And I'm just wondering, how have you thought about how to reach that particular intersect?
Well, the comment Professor Avital made was basically, you know, I'm not often able to have kinship with people. You get me. And I know, and I get her children. I haven't even met her children yet, but I get them too. I understand. I think one of the most important parts is having several dialogues. One is among each other as African American Jews, Another one is between African American Jews and our fellow African Americans. Really important. And as we discussed earlier between each other, I'm very, just in the same way if someone had told me that a humanistic Jew or a secular Jew wasn't a Jew. I feel the same way about African Americans, calling black, I say blacks involved in Judaism. So I feel like Hebrew Israelite and me are not the same, but I still feel they're part of my family. Because I know their rabbis, their people, and if you go to their services, it's basically the same as any other Jewish service. But whether other people accept them is really not my problem. It's not my job. So I consider them part of my family. Another part is to have, I think, create a dialogue among younger Jews. Because as we said at the table, we have to resolve this. Because intersectionality in terms of American Jews is here. And by the way, some of y'all be like, oh, it's just the brown and yellow and red children. Mm-mm. Guess what? All them Irish mamas that are now going to have grandchildren, next generation or two, in the Jewish community, particularly in the Reform movement. When I asked my kids in my Reform synagogue, huge Reform synagogue, how many of you have a non-Jewish person in your immediate family? Everybody raised a hand. Almost all those people were white identified. Now, we have people in the community trying to figure out what to do with Jews of color. I'm like, hold up, you forgot something. White identity, which helped American Jews assimilate, is coming back to roost. Because when my kids, who don't look Jewish, and there are half or three quarters white, whatever, not white, non-Jewish, go out, and when they reject it, they have no one to answer to. Because they can pass. You feel me? And same thing happened in my own family when many of my family members passed into whiteness. You know, they were three quarters white and they didn't show it. They could just walk on out. So I am all for Jewish pluralism. And I don't think that anybody's converts are less acceptable than anybody else. That's not my deal. I'm just saying that you have a large population of American Jews who can blend in and become just white people. And, you know, whether Jews of color are valid is the least of your problems. Because you have a whole large growing population that doesn't have to make the choice to be different anymore. That doesn't have to make the choice to stand out. And I think that's something that we're really gonna have to talk about and deal with. Because in a while, my youngest and her youngest, you're gonna be begging them to come around because they're the ones who are gonna be stark yidden, who are gonna be devoted and dedicated to our tradition, while other folks can make that choice to pass in or pass out. So, you know, we have bigger fish to fry, as we say in the black community, in those terms. But what I want to leave you with is this. I want to thank you, first of all, for being open to my presence and what I have to say. I hope that some of it is challenging. I hope that some of it does complicate your ideas about both peoples and what it means to be an American. You know, I was told when I tried to sell my book to a certain publisher that I could not represent myself as a Jewish person because that would be too much for people to handle. The editor basically, no, she didn't basically say anything. She said directly into my ear, America's not ready for you. What an insult. Because this is America, you can be anybody you want in this country. I really do believe that. I'm only possible here, you know? And I just thought to myself, I'm gonna set out to prove you wrong. Because by saying that America's not ready for me is like saying America's not ready for her children, who are a reality. Saying America's not ready for many other Jewish people of color who are already here, and we are Asian, we are Native American, we are Latino, we are a multiracial, we are African American, we're from the Indian subcontinent, we're Ethiopian, we're West African, and we are going to be here for a long time to come. So, todah rabah, thank you very much, and have a good night.